Hey folks, David Stewart here. It's time for something a little bit different, which is YouTube equipment setups. What kind of equipment do you need to record YouTube videos? This video is kind of a response because I've had lots of people ask me about my YouTube lighting setup. They notice that I'm using some red and blue lights and they want to know more about why I do that or what my lighting setup is. But I thought it'd be an opportunity to talk about a bunch of things related to making YouTube videos, a lot of recommendations for people that are looking to jump into making either vlogs or YouTube videos in other formats, just to reveal some of the things that I've learned through trial and error along the way, a bunch of little tips to help make your videos look and sound their absolute best. Let's actually start with the camera rather than the lighting. I use a Logitech C920 camera. I recommend that you use this camera or the newest version of it, the C930, 940, whatever it happens to be, rather than the 600 series. So I started off with the 600 series, and even though they both record in 1080p, this one is a lot better. I'll tell you that right now. So upgrading to the better quality one did make a much bigger difference. The optics on it are better. It just records a better image. The 600 is an okay one to start with. However, I don't recommend you really start with it because the difference in price is only like $30 or $50. You're looking at like $60 for the 600 series versus $100 for the, you know, for the top of the line, better Logitech camera. Just get the better one because the money difference, it's gonna be negligible as you use it. If you actually use it over time, over a number of years, it's gonna become just a lot more negligible. You know, I've used this camera for 3 or 4 years, so the difference in price between the two, and I bought both, it was still worth it to buy the upgraded one. I even have one that's newer, a 930 that's actually, maybe you can see it, it's on a little mic stand over here. Right, and it's basically set up to be a document camera, so I can show things, you know, right here, like I can show comics or the D&D box the other week. So it's set up as a document camera because it's a wider angle lens. That's why I don't use it for this one, even though it's newer. The wider angle lens takes in too much of the room, and I want the image to really be focused on me because it's me talking, so I don't need quite as much background. So I recommend one that's a little bit tighter for that. And I do recommend the higher quality camera compared to the 600 series. The only thing that I will say is not that great about my camera is that it forgets the white setting. Here's the white balance. So every time I restart it, it starts like with this ghastly ultra cool setting and I have to put it back in the middle. Let's move on to lighting. So here's some basic tips for lighting. First one is you want to use at least two light sources. I use three, but two is the standard. You have a main light source, which is very slightly off of center. So take center and just move it a couple degrees off. And so that gives a really bright light here. And then you have a fill light that's further off to the side. The point of two light sources is it minimizes shadows across the face. You want those light sources at the level of the face. You don't want them above or below. If they're below, they cast odd shadows. If they're above, they make you look very old and sinister and kind of creepy, right? If you're going for that, of course, if you're a cinematographer, harsh overhead lighting is going to make the actor look a lot more sinister. But you don't want to look sinister on your YouTube videos. You want to look attractive. So a bright main light and a softer fill light. I use three. And my three are actually colors. So this is what most people ask. So I use a red and a blue fill light on either side. So that's what it looks like without the main light on. So blue on one side, red on the other. And you notice right away, as soon as I get rid of the main front light that lights the front of my face, I start to look different. You know, I don't look quite as thin. I maybe look older. You can see bags under my eyes. The shadows get a lot harsher. However, the red and blue light I like a lot. It reminds me of stepping on stage. This was a stage lighting technique that we used to use, you know, at clubs for years when I played. Is that the main stage was lit with red and blue, which was enough light that you could see all the performers. But when you were on stage, it didn't feel so harsh and bright and blinding. And then for the spotlight, you used a nice bright center light for the singer. And it let the audience really clearly see whatever you wanted them to see, but at the same time, it kept the performers visible and yet comfortable, so it didn't feel quite so harsh on stage. So I liked that, and it reminds me of that stage, and it just gives an interesting dynamic color fill to the fill lights that I think looks interesting. It's an experiment that I did, and I just liked the way it looked, so I kept it. And you can do something similar or not. Now, for your main lights, I do recommend this. I recommend a bright white light bulb, not bright white, I'm sorry, daylight light bulb, not bright white. So there's three different versions. There is Soft white, which actually looks very yellow on camera. You don't want to use that. I learned that the hard way. You have bright white, which is a little bit more white. And then you have daylight, which is the brightest, highest white point light that you can get. You want daylight. It reveals all the colors properly. With your camera, because you have this white balance slider, you can always dial it in just perfect to the way that you want it to be, to show exactly what you want it to show. Daylight lights are where it's at. Next thing is you want to use diffuser cloths. I happen to have an extra one here. This is from a soft box that I don't really use much, but I've used it for like mobile recording. You can buy the diffuser cloth off of Amazon just by itself for very cheap, you know, a couple dollars, and cut it to whatever size you need. Just throw it on your light fixture and you're good to go. You do not want the raw light bulb. The raw light bulb is going to look really, really harsh and it's going to blanch you out too much. You want it to be diffused like it's a cloudy day. That's why cinematographers like to shoot on cloudy days. It gets rid of the harsh shadows. So the diffuser cloth, not just over the light bulb, but as wide a dispersion as possible. So the reason softboxes have a big square is that it makes the light source feel like a big square rather than a single point of light. So the wider you can make it, generally the better, but if you move the light source back a little bit, you're going to get somewhat of a similar effect as well. I don't use a diffuser cloth on my blue light because it just looks better without it. I use it on my red light and use it on my main light, and I don't use it on my background light anymore, but I could if I wanted to. So these are very cheap. You can get them, you know, really, really cheap. The other thing is light fixtures. So these are basically the light fixtures I use. I use a couple of desk lamps on some, you know, little boom stands that just have this cone. So this keeps it from lighting up like the back. You know, you could take this off and have just the light bulb, if not, well, not this, but mine. You could actually take the cone off and just have the light bulb and it would light up everything else. But I like it to be a little bit more focused than that. But you can get these and just put a diffuser cloth over them with a bright white light bulb. They clip on. And the clip on these, I got these from Home Depot. That's very strong. You got to really squeeze to get that guy open. It stays put with some foam pads on microphone stands, on anything, pretty much anything that you can open it up big enough to clip onto a desktop. I use one. My red light uses one of these just clipped on a windowsill. The green light uses one of these just clipped on a desk leg, and you can use them wherever. And the great thing about these is if you decide to go mobile, you can just pick these up and take them with you wherever you need to go and clip them on whatever. The goosenecks are very sturdy and you can point the light, you know, wherever you need it to go. Throw a diffuser cloth on it like this. Boom. And boom, there's your light source. Very cheap. So for less than $30, buying two of these, a piece of diffuser cloth off Amazon and a couple of bright white light bulbs, you have a superior lighting setup that's going to be better than most beginning YouTubers, and that's going to help set you up from the crowd, I think. Before I go further, let me talk a little bit about mobile. So I've talked about PC stuff, but I actually started this channel on a mobile phone. I started recording the videos on an iPhone 5, and your mobile phone is actually a really, really good option for just getting started. So if you don't want to spend any of this money for buying a camera and stuff, you can start right away with your phone, and surprisingly, the quality of videos on your phone is really good. So whatever helps you get the content out, that's good. I started with a phone, and I still record videos on my phone, but I use some of the techniques that I've learned as I've gone, including better lighting sources and things like that to make the image look better, and as well as better audio sources. So let me transition into talking about audio. Audio is extremely important for YouTube videos. I have learned this. You want your audio to be nice, clear quality. You want it to be loud enough. And mainly you want to use good microphones. The microphone that I use, it's a Rode NT1A. This is one of the original NT1As. This is called a pop filter. You don't necessarily need this, and I'll explain why. My Rode mics, I bought a matched pair 16, 17 years ago, a long time ago I bought them. And I used them for everything since. They're just a great set of microphones. However, I think most people who are getting into this aren't going to want to buy dedicated studio mics. They're probably going to buy a USB mic. But that's what I use, and I use a Scarlett 18i8 interface to power it. You need an interface with phantom power to power a condenser microphone. Now, mine has four microphone inputs. You don't need that many, chances are, because you're not recording quadraphonic orchestra like I have in the past. So you just need maybe a Scarlett Solo and a good mic if you want to go that route, and that's it's probably all you're going to really want to do, that's still going to be more expensive and more options than what most people want to do, and they're just going to want to go with a USB mic. So if you're going to go with a USB mic, here's the one that I have and the one that I actually recommend for most people. This is the Blue Yeti, and yes, mine is actually blue, which matches my phone. This is a great quality microphone for the price. I couldn't believe what high quality I got with this microphone. I bought it for $90 on an Amazon Day sale, and it has so many options. You can even get a version of this that has an XLR output, so you can use it like a regular microphone with an interface or with a mixing board or something. This microphone, besides it being a great condenser microphone and sounding really, really good, it has a bunch of options. You have a headphone volume, so you can plug your headphones into this and monitor yourself or use it as a sound card. You have a mute button, which is super useful. You have gain. It's in a weird place on the back of the microphone, like you have to reach around to do the gain. But it has this selection for different microphone, what are called recording patterns. So the main pattern you want to use is a cardioid recording pattern, which just records stuff in front of you, like this, kind of in a little range in front of you. But this one also has a figure eight, which records stuff in front and behind. So you could get the sound of reverb in a room and you, or you could record two people. Like you could put this me on one side, another person on the other side, and it records both of us without recording the stuff on the side very much. It also has omnidirectional, so you could put this in the center of a room and record everything in it, or put it in the center of a group of people, like on a table. So if you're recording a D&D match, you just put this in the middle of the omnidirectional and everybody sounds super crystal clear in it. It's beautiful. And then there's also a stereo array, and the stereo array is what I have used to record myself and say Matt Wellman if we're recording outside. I do that. Now, I mentioned I use this for recording outside. That is because here's the other cool thing about this microphone and similar microphones to it. It's USB class compliant. What that means is it basically works with everything, including a mobile phone. So I have a Pixel XL. It's an original one. If you have a newer one, I believe it will also work with that. I think I've tested this on a newer one from a friend. You get a USB-C to USB-A adapter. You plug it in your microphone, and with a third-party recording application like Open Camera, you can use this microphone to record on your phone, and it sounds great. So it's a great option to add on to a phone recording setup or to use for a PC recording setup. I've also tested this with Chrome OS. So if you have a Chromebook that you want to record on, this microphone will sound great on it. And I think it's worked on various Linux platforms as well. So it works with pretty much everything. What a great and cool idea that you could use this on your Android phone or on Chrome OS or a bunch of different ways that you can use this. It's a great one to get. It sounds great. It sounds great for recording guitar. I've recorded guitar videos with it. Just a really good microphone all around. That's the one I recommend. You can also get the Rode Podcaster if you want the equivalent of my NT1A. It's basically an NT1A with a USB recording device that converts it to USB attached onto it. So it's also going to be pretty high quality as well. And I know a lot of people use that Rode Podcaster. So the audio quality is important. A lot of people think too much and like, I have to get lots of acoustic treatment for my room. You really, really don't. As long as you are talking loudly and you have your microphone set up in the correct placement, it's probably not going to be a big deal. This room is way boomier than my old room, and it still sounds fine in here. I didn't put up a bunch of foam. I just have furniture in the room. If it's a totally empty room or like a foyer at some hospital, it's going to not sound as good as a regular room. But once you have a room full of stuff, it's really not too bad. Last thing I'll say about audio is the distance for your microphone kind of matters. A lot of people see a live performer using what's called a dynamic mic. I don't recommend you use a dynamic mic. In the past, I've reviewed some dynamic mics that are an option, including one by Samson. If you have to get a really cheap microphone or you were only recording in very loud spaces, a dynamic microphone is the better choice. But for most people, you want a cardioid mic, and that's going to be one of these ones like the Blue Yeti. The thing is, a lot of people try to put these too close to their face, and it gives a very unnatural sound. Even big YouTubers, they think that they have to record with the microphone very close to their face. The problem with that is that you don't hear other people by listening up into their face. So if you think of the microphone as an ear, that's not the placement that you actually want for the microphone to have it sound natural. So I have mine about 16 inches away from my face, slightly off center, so that the power of my articulations, such as my plosives, my papas, and my tatas, and my sss, is going forward, not directly into the microphone. And I have enough space that that amplitude of those harsh pronunciations, those harsh enunciations, gets rolled off a little bit. So it rolls off the high end the further away you get. And if you put it very close, that makes all of your p-p-ps very, very harsh, and you have to get a pop filter. Now, I do have a pop filter on my mic, but that's just an extra thing. You don't really have to use it if you're using it a little bit further away. So if you get the Blue Yeti, you don't really have to use a pop filter. It basically has a foam filter inside to help reduce some of that. And if you have it about 12 to 20 inches away from your face, the microphone is going to sound just fine. Don't make the mistake of eating the microphone like you see somebody on stage. That's just going to make you sound really weird. It's going to be useful for ASMR videos, so I guess that's the next thing. If you want to do ASMR videos, get a great quality mic, put it right up on your face, and then you can whisper into it very quietly. And that's the sound people want for ASMR videos, so that's another thing that you can do. That's basically all the stuff that I have set up for my entire setup. I will say one last thing. I have a light to light up my background. If you're going to record in a room like I do, it's nice to have some stuff in the background that people can look to. People often comment about the lava lamp, about, you know, my little friend Piglet here for not Godzilla. I think I need to put Godzilla in a place where, like, you know, people can really see Godzilla properly. He's mostly in here so my son comes in to hang out while I'm working. He can play with Godzilla and my micro machines. But, you know, guitars. So have something in the background that people can kind of attach themselves to. Maybe they get bored of looking at your face and they start staring at the lava lamp. I know some people do. It's just an idea. It's something that I figured out people like that little visual detail. So have one of those in there. Some people do like Christmas lights and bookshelves, stuff like that. So think about something in the background that gives a slight bit of interest for people who are tired of staring at your mug and your mouth moving slowly or whatever it's going to be. So that's my all my recommendations. The last bit I will say is software. So I use OBS to record, and OBS works really good for me. I use it to stream and record. I don't use Streamlabs OBS or any of that kind of stuff because I haven't bothered with that yet. Maybe I will in the future, and I'll give you more information as I learn. OBS is great. It's very powerful. Lets you use a variety of sources. Lets me do stuff where I can have like two cameras and show stuff over here, right? It lets me do, my face plus something on a capture on a monitor. It's just the best software that I've found to do this kind of thing, and it tends to work really, really, really well. So that's my entire setup. You can use that however you want to accomplish whatever you want with your YouTube videos. It's great if you're starting out to be able to start off with a leg up and not have to learn all this stuff the hard way. So good camera, good mic, diffusers, multiple light sources. I think that's it, OBS. And that's how you're going to create some okay YouTube videos. And thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And I'll see you guys next time.